Since there's only a couple of you that I know, I'm asking you a question. What's your first impression? When someone new walks through that door, you need to ask yourself that question. Do you look at them the way you think? Or do you look at them the way you've got? We all have a need for Christ. And if first impressions, if we're not careful, we'll move someone out that door and lose it for us.
That's right.
So be careful. First impressions can be interesting. I love machines when they work. When I look back at what I thought was living, I am amazed at the price I chose to pay. And to think I ignored what really mattered, cause I thought the sacrifice would be too great. But when I finally reached the point of giving in, I found the cross was calling even then. And even though it took dying to survive, I never felt so much alive. For I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. Not I, but Christ who lives within me. His cross will never ask for more than I can give. For it's not my strength, but His. There's no greater sacrifice. For I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. As I'm here to save your call, your daily dying, I will bow beneath the weight of Calvary. Let my hands surrender to His piercing purpose that holds me to the cross, yet sets me free. I will glory in the power of the cross. The things I thought were gain are now a loss. And with His suffering I identify. And by His resurrection power, I will rise. His cross will never ask for more than I can give. For it's not my strength, but His. There's a greater sacrifice. For I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. Are you?
Wow.
Are you?
Yes.
Because if you're not, you're missing out.
That's right.
Are you just a spectator at the cross? Are you hugging that thing with all you got? He sacrificed all for us.
That's right.
But why did he do that? Because we're a mess.
Yes.
I mean, a mess. And we prove it every day. And you see it in the news. And you see it on TV. We need him.
That's right.
And we're not for the grace of God. He was sat at the right hand of the Father. And we all belong. He gave himself to come in human form and take on our sin for his glory. Does that make any sense? It doesn't. Glory not for grace. I didn't want to think about it. Is that too loud? Is it too loud?
No, no, no.
Good. I didn't see anybody here.
One ring down some points, let's roll.
Church, let me just say what a joy and what a privilege it is to be here in your presence this evening. I can't begin to tell you how much your hospitality, your kindness, your love already expressed to my wife and myself, Brother Larry, Karen, we love y'all. You're dear, dear friends to us, but I want you to know you are all dear friends.
Amen.
And I love each one of them. Even though I don't even know you. So don't ask me to call you by your name because I'm old. I'm 56. You say, well, that may be young for some of y'all, but I'm telling you, my mind is already out. The heart is willing, but the mind is unable. I go to the well and there's nothing there. Anybody ever like that? But I do love and appreciate so much the opportunity that God has blessed me with to be here with you tonight. I can't imagine ever foreseen getting a call from Brother Larry and asking me if I'd be willing to preach. And if you serve as an executive pastor, if somebody says preach, you say, you come and win. I'm ready.
Yeah.
All right. We don't get a lot of opportunities, but when we do, man, I tell you what, I want to, there's no greater joy than proclaim the truth of God's word.
Amen.
Nothing will set your heart on fire like that. Now, y'all, thank you for the meal. Frank, thank you for the special music.
Amen.
It has been a good night already,
Amen.
Hasn't it?
Amen.
All right. Well, we're gonna go to the Lord here in a word of prayer, and then we're gonna hear a word from the Lord this evening. So if you will, just bow your heads, just momentarily. Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Father, right now we ask for your blessing upon this time. Father, we ask that you would open our hearts and our minds to the glorious magnificence of your truth in your word. The Father, that you would impart these truths to us, that we would learn these truths, and Father, that you would just put them into effect in our life, and that we would joyfully live them out for our good, but Father, ultimately for your glory.
That's right.
So, Father, you speak here tonight. It's your time. You do with it as you will. We give you all praise and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
As I prayed about and upon this invitation to speak here, I prayed what God might have me to speak on. I'm doing a series on Wednesday nights in our church in the Gospel of John. Been methodically plodding through John. It would have been really, really easy to me, and it was very, very tempting to say, you know what? I'm a John 15. I know John 17 is coming up. I can build a whole sermon series around John 17, and it would have been perfect if the Lord had been in it.
Right.
The Lord saw fit to direct my path a different way. So I'm going to go ahead and tell you tonight, if you're okay, this is where we're going to go. For the next four nights, we're going to do a series, and we're going to be looking at but God moments. When Scripture says the words, but God, there's about 45 instances of that in Scripture recorded. Each one God is at work and God is the great interrupter. When it says God, but God, you can bet that God is on the scene and he's getting ready and he's interrupting. Are you okay if God interrupts our lives?
Yes.
Amen.
I can think of nothing better than for God to show up in our lives and interrupt our plans, our purposes, and install his plans and his purposes in our life. To reacquaint us, to refresh us, to renew us. So tonight as we do that, we're going to be looking at Acts chapter 13. Will be the first but God moment that we look at. Acts chapter 13. As you make your way there, those two words, but God. If I were to ask people what their two most important words were in human language, we would come up with a very varied and diverse set of responses. Some people would argue and say, thank you. If you're teaching your kids, one of the things you teach your children is to say, thank you. Why? Everyone loves to feel appreciated, don't they? If you're getting ready to get married, the first two most two important words may be, I do. If you are married, it's yes, dear. Okay?
Amen.
Amen.
If later on in life, as you get older, you realize that many times things have been put off. And so some people may say, act now would be the most important words. Nike, that very famous sports apparel company, used the words just do it. They added the word just in front of it, but the sentiment was still the same. Act now. Do it. Just get up and get in motion. Don't put off tomorrow what you can do today. Well, I will tell you that but God, that phrase, that conjunctive phrase, but connecting two thoughts or two ideas, contrasting those two ideas, and you add God and God adds himself onto the end of it, it makes all things possible.
Amen.
That's right.
There's nothing that's impossible with God. There's nothing that's too hard for God. And so we have these but God moments that can affect any situation, that can affect any outcome. As we think on that, when we think on those but God moments, I pray we've already sung about, I pray that it would be true in each person in this room that you've had a but God moment. Where God interrupted your life, he introduced you to the fact that you were a sinner in need of a Savior, and he interrupted your life in such a way to present you with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The way, the truth, and the life. That is the greatest but God moment that has ever been recorded in history. The resurrection is the ultimate but God moment. And that's what we're going to see in Acts chapter 13. Paul and Barnabas had just been commissioned by the church in Antioch. They laid hands, they fasted, they prayed, they commissioned them, and they had sent them out. This is the first missionary journey. We know in the book of Acts, we see Jesus coming to the end of his earthly ministry. He ascends to the Father. He gives us the Great Commission. He sends the Holy Spirit. Peter preaches at Pentecost. 3,000 are saved, and the birth of the church is in full motion. Persecution comes, and we have the dispersion that's going about to spread the gospel. And because the Jews have rejected the person of Jesus Christ, the gospel is going out to the Gentiles.
Right.
And Paul, beginning in chapter 13, Paul comes on the scene. And so the transition takes place, and we see the birth of the church, and it's an exciting time. Church, this is the beginnings of how you and I came to hear the gospel.
Amen.
This is where it all began. That ought to light a fire. And as Abraham Rogers would say, if it doesn't light your fire, somebody wet your wood.
That's right.
Okay? Alright? But it ought to light us on fire when we think about the fact that this is how and where the gospel began coming to us. God in his providence and in his plan and his sovereignty sent the gospel to us here. And it began with Paul and Barnabas. Paul, a great persecutor of the church, has had a but God moment. And he has sent and used Paul to come and preach the gospel. He's gone out And now we find him in chapter 13, where we're going to camp out here tonight in Antioch, Pisidian. And he preaches a sermon. It's the first recorded sermon of Paul that we have in the scripture. So if you're in Acts chapter 13, if you will find your way to verse 26, if you're there, say amen.
Amen.
And we'll begin our reading. Brothers, sons of the family of Abraham, and those among you who fear God, to us has been sent the message of this salvation. For those who live in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not recognize him nor understand the utterances of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath, fulfilled them by condemning him. And though they found in him no guilt worthy of death, they asked Pilate to have him executed. And when they had carried out all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead.
Amen.
And for many days he appeared to those who had come up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are now his witnesses to the people. And we bring you the good news that what God had promised to the fathers, this he has fulfilled to us, their children, by raising Jesus. But God raised him from the dead. The greatest interruption in all history. If God doesn't raise Jesus from the dead, we're hopeless. We're helpless. We're still trapped in our sin. And we might as well just get up and walk out of these doors.
Amen.
But God raised him from the dead.
That's right.
And church, we need to never lose sight of that. That should never grow old within us. That is what will propel you forward. And within this text here tonight, I believe I'm going to call out about four principles that I believe that we'll see, that we can just cling to, and we can think, and we can frame our thinking around a but God moment. And it will change our lens. It will give us focus, and it will help us. So the first but God principle that we see here that is applied to everyone who's ever been born is that God has a message for us. Mm-hmm. Look there in verse 26. Brothers, sons of the family of Abraham, and those among you who fear God, those are the Gentiles who are believers, all right, who are following, wanting to hear. Paul is preaching here at the synagogue. For to us has been sent the message of this salvation. There's a message to everybody who's born. God, we use the term general revelation for that. And God in his creation, when God spoke the world into existence. Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created. He created out of nothing. Ex nihilo. He spoke and planets birthed forth. Stars were put into orbit in motion. Things came about because God spoke. And God, when he spoke, his creation began to cry out and to declare the glory of God. The psalmist records it this way in Psalm 19:1. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. How many of you just enjoy just being out in nature?
Yes.
And just observing the handiwork of God. My wife and I, we just had the pleasure of being able to take about a 7-day trip with our family. We went to Florida. We love the sand. We love the surf. We love the ocean. And as I sat there in that chair, smelling like bacon frying in that hot sun, okay, you get the picture. So as I'm there, I cannot help but look out across that ocean. And as far as I can see, there's nothing but water. And that water of hydrogen and oxygen molecules, every one of them was put together precisely by God.
Amen.
And those fish that I saw, even the jellyfish that were stinging some people, they were created by God. That sun and that sand, when I looked at that sand, I think of God's promise to Abraham. I could not help when everything that you see, everything that you look at, you just see God. I've had the pleasure of being able to go out and been fortunate to go on some mission trips. I've been able to go to Alaska on missions. And just to see the difference of God's handiwork in Alaska. I've been to the Dakar Synagogue, and I've been able to see God's handiwork there. My son and I took a trip. We kept procrastinating, but we finally took a trip. And right as I surrendered the ministry, we went to the Grand Canyon. I'll never forget just seeing this vast carving of God in the earth's crust. And when the sunlight hit it, the beauty of all the different layers and striations and marks within the rock.
Right.
It was all done by God. And every bit of it was crying out and saying, I am God. I am the Creator. There is no other. That's God's general revelation. That's what He says about Himself. When we look out in God's creation and we see that, can I just remind this church for just a moment that on the sixth day God created man, and He created man in His own image. And if all of God's inanimate objects that He created are crying out that He is God, does it not seem that we, the pinnacle of His creation, should be continually and constantly crying out, He is God, and He is Lord over all? And yet in a world today where it seems to be that we go silent, why is that? He is God. He is the Creator. He created you with a plan and a purpose. He knew you before the foundation of the world. And He has a message for you. And God has been declaring that message since the beginning. Not only did He declare it through His general revelation, He declared it through a very specific revelation. He sent prophets. And He had a message. And He's been speaking to man all along. And everything within this book, from Alpha to Omega, from stem to stern, from page, front page to the last page of it, including the concordance, everything that ever pays in it is pointing to Jesus. He has a message for us. He has a message for you tonight. And I'm not talking about just a message of salvation. I'm talking about a message for you, for His plan and His purpose for you in your life.
Amen.
I've heard the word retirement used tonight. There is no retirement with God. When God retires you, you go home to glory.
That's
until
right.
then, you're about His plan and His purpose to bring Him glory. Until then, that's it. When you've accomplished the last thing on this earth for you to do for His glory, He'll bring you home.
Amen.
That's retirement. That's a lot better than a 401k right now.
That's right.
It always has been. So, we see this message. God crying out. He is the Creator. I think of Romans there in chapter 1, 18 through 20 about His creation. Where Paul records these words, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them."
Right.
"For His invisible attributes, namely His eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse." We've got enough revelation of God to know that we're sinners and we need a Savior. Amen. But the full revelation of God had not been given at the time of, had just been given until the time of this. And we have the full revelations. We're looking at it from this side of the cross. Okay. And we have the full, complete Word, infallible Word of God to tell us the whole truth.
Right.
We're without excuse.
Right.
And our job is to share that message, that good news, that hope, that "but God" moment that you experience with a lost and dying world. That's what He's chartered us with. Oh, what an awesome responsibility. Not only is it an awesome responsibility, but what a joyous task. I can think of no greater joy than sharing the truth of God's Word with someone. He wants to communicate. He's a personal God. He wants to communicate this message. He wants to communicate it with those that He created. In Hebrews 1:1, long ago and many times in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by prophets. He spoke to Moses through burning bush. He spoke on Mount Sinai through lightning. He spoke through Elijah through a whisper. Oh, God is then at work and He's speaking, and He's speaking still today in and through the truth of His Word to you and I. He's got a message. Why did God long to speak to us? because he loves us. Because he created us with a purpose and a plan, and he wants to reveal that to us. I hear people struggle all the time about life and what life, what's the meaning of life. It's very, very simple. God didn't try to hide that. He clearly revealed it. It has always been about giving glory to him.
Amen.
He created you with a purpose and a plan, and it is to give him all glory, to be ascribed to him, the creator, the savior of the world. You want to know your greatest purpose? Glorify God. You can glorify him in your work. You can glorify him in your singing. You can glorify him in your family. You can glorify him every moment of every day. That's the message that he has for us. That he is God. We were created within a time-space continuum, if you will. God created time. God created space. He put man in it. Man's trying to get out of that because we know there's something beyond that. Mm-hmm. We know there's God. So what does man do? Man tries to find every way he can out of this box of time and space. He can't do it. But God, in his great love, what did he do? He entered the box. He entered time and space. He came to us because we couldn't get out of it. Every time that someone comes up with a new idea of how to get out of the box, a new religion is born. Church, can I just remind us, we don't need a new religion. We need a relationship.
Amen.
We don't need religion at all. We just need relationship with the one who came.
That's right.
We need to be refreshed and renewed in that. It doesn't need to be about religion. Never has been. This is what sets all Christianity apart from all other religions. God came to us in humility, took on the form of man, and lived a perfect life. And died the death that we should have died.
That's right.
But God raised him from the dead.
Amen.
That's right.
And from that, you have hope.
That's right.
That's the message. Augustine said it this way. How much does God love you? God loves each of us as if there was only one of us to love. Isn't that amazing? Let's make that personal. If you were the only sinner and the only person on all of earth, God would have came and sent his son to die for you, to give you life, to give you opportunity, to draw you back into relationship with him. That's how much he loves you. Now, I don't know about you. I only have one grandson, but I have two children. Both my children think they're the favorite. Don't tell them any different. Amen?
That's right.
But with God, it's true. Every person created is loved equally by God. Every person created is loved equally by God. That's his message. You may think that you are here tonight by your own choosing. You're not. You're here on a divine appointment. God loves you and he drew you here in his providence and in his plan. And he has a message for you tonight. The second point is simply this. Not only does God have a message for us, he sent a messenger to us. Look at verse 27. For those who live in Jerusalem and the rulers, because they did not recognize him. Paul has just moved from a message, to a person, him. Can I just say this? God's message has never been a sermon. God's message has never been some creed. God's message has always been a person.
Right.
And the person is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Every message ever given has been pointing to the way, the truth, and the life. The light, the gate. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who entered into that time, space, continuum for you and I. He is the message and the messenger.
Amen.
Church, that's why we're here. We have to be constantly reminded. Because you know why? Everything in this world is telling us the message isn't important, the messenger isn't important, and it's constantly trying to influence you and I. There's something that cannot be stopped. You can't stop influencing and you can't stop being influenced.
That's true.
It's just a matter of who are you being influenced by? And who are you influencing and what are you influencing them with? Are we going to be a people that is influenced by the truth of God's word continually till the day he calls us home? And that we're going to share that and we're going to be committed to influencing others with this truth? Or are we going to allow ourselves to have that message diluted? To have that message changed? To have that message put to a lesser point and priority in our lives? It's really a but God moment. The messenger. The perfect messenger.
Yes.
Let me finish. I read Hebrews 1, part of it there. Let me read through verse 2. Long ago, in many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world.
That's right.
And on that cross, what did he say? The telestai is finished.
It's finished.
It's finished.
The completed work of Christ. It's not over. He's coming back. But the work for you and I, the message, has been completed by the messenger. There's going to be a time when the message is going to be pulled back. There's not going to be enough. There's not going to be a chance for you to respond to the message. That day's coming. But for now, his hand of love and grace is extended. He's saying, accept the message and the messenger. He's calling. What are you going to do with it? What am I going to do with it? I love John. I'm reminded of John's gospel there because I've been studying it. But it just comes to my mind when I think about this, is Jesus being the message and the messenger. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it.
That's right.
And then you come on down to verse 14, and it gets better. You say, well, what could be better? And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus, God coming down to us. This is the truth that separates us in Christianity. All other man's futile attempts, all that other religion, it's an exercise in futility.
Mm-hmm.
Never would work, can't work, but God took on flesh. But God lived a life I couldn't live. But God bore my sin on the cross. But God bled my blood, the blood that should have been shed for me and by me. Oh, that's the truth that we constantly have to be reminded of. It's a truth that cannot grow old. If we are going to have revival, that truth has to be at the center of everything that we say, everything that we do. You can't say it enough. You can't shout it loud enough. You can't live it out enough.
Right.
It's the truth of revival that Jesus Christ, but God loves you so much that he sent his Son for you.
Amen.
The essence of revival begins with that truth. You can't have revival without that truth. You can't schedule revival. What you can do is get on your knees and you can pray and you can say, God, you are God of all, and I want to make you but God in my life again. Not that he ever left, but I want to give you that priority in my life. I want to give you, I want that message to resonate within me. I want to be, that's what I want to talk about. That's what I want to think about. That's what I want to pray about. And God will light that fire. You will share that. You know what I find? The more you study God's word, the more you want to talk about God.
Sorry.
The more you watch TV, the more you want to talk about TV. The more you watch the news, the more you want to talk about the news. The more you look at your bank account, the more you want to look at your talk about your bank account. But God will interrupt your life.
That's right.
You let him. You know what he'll do? He'll become the object of your desire, the object of your affection, the object of your speech, the object of your love. If you just let him. Oh, that's revival.
That's right.
The messenger is the message, and the message is one of hope and love and forgiveness and grace, and it's all found in Christ alone.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
It's not a creed, it's not a ritual, it's not an institution. Our faith is in Christ alone. It's meeting and accepting the message and the messenger personally and having a relationship with him. Church, I'm just going to tell you, I'm used to seeing a clock back here on the wall. So y'all better hang on to your bootstraps. Right? Just a little bit more. Not only is there the message and the messenger, but God knows the mess of our sin.
Yes.
Look at verse 28. And though they found him no guilt worthy of death, they asked Pilate to have him executed. A guiltless man. No fault within him. And yet they crucified him. The Messiah was innocent. The Savior was innocent. Church, it's always been confusing about who Jesus was at this time. Some thought he was a good man, John chapter 7. Some thought he was a deceiver over in Matthew chapter 16. Some thought that they wanted to make him their king after he fed the multitude in John 6. Some said he had a demon over in John 7. Some thought he was Elijah. But they rejected who he truly was. So here's the real question for us tonight. Who do you say Jesus is? It makes all the difference in the world how we answer that question.
Right.
We acknowledge the truth of who he is, that he is the Savior, the only way. He'll shine light in your life. And here's the thing. You say, I've been saved by grace and faith and blood of Jesus Christ. I say amen. Praise God. But I would also challenge the church, what about unconfessed, unrepentant sin? You say, I'm not growing. Could it be that there's unconfessed, unrepentant sin in your heart? God will shine a light on that if you allow him. We won't like it. It won't be pleasant. But what it will do is it'll set you free. And you won't grow in the Spirit of God until you come to give him that unconfessed and unrepentant sin. You won't experience revival until you give it him that unconfessed and unrepentant of your sin. Confession with the mouth. Repentance is faith are two sides of that same coin. Repentance, acknowledging before God, being sorrowful and broken in a contrite heart over and calling sin for what it is, calling it what God calls it, and turning from that sin and turning and receiving that forgiveness that God says he's faithful and just and he'll give you. And he'll restore you. You can have a but God moment right there. Not only that, you say, well, Todd, Brother Todd, I'm just not a fanatic about Jesus. I have a relationship with God, and I like to keep mine quiet, and I like to keep it over here, and that's just personal between me and God, and, you know, you're kind of stepping on my toes. Well, I'm stepping on mine, too, so it's okay. Let me tell you something. How about we go to a ball game with your favorite team? You tell me you're not a fanatic. Let's go watch UT play football or basketball or soccer or baseball, whatever it is. Let's see how excited you get. I'd say that it's not that you're not a fanatic. I'd just say you're a fanatic about the wrong thing. Is that okay? Is that too harsh?
That's a little much.
How about if we become fanatical about Christ? He'll radically change our lives.
Amen.
That's right.
And then finally, God works a miracle in spite of us. But God raised him from the dead. Aren't you glad that God has the last word?
Amen.
It wasn't Pilate. It wasn't the crowd that said, crucify him, crucify him. It wasn't that fickleness. God has the final say. And God said, it's sufficient. The propitiation, the penalty has been paid.
Amen.
He said, but God raised him from the dead.
Amen.
Church, right here tonight, there may be somebody here that has never experienced a God moment. Can I just say your salvation is not a moment in time. Your salvation is a series of moments that continues throughout a lifetime.
Right. That's right.
It's not a one-time thing. If your salvation has been one point in time and you're looking back on it and you've never experienced God, I would ask you to question yourself with the truth of God's word. Go to 1 John and say, what is it that you claim to have? Because what will happen is it will bear fruit and it will grow. There's somebody here that doesn't know how you're going to get through tomorrow. You can have but God tomorrow. God, but God will give you the strength.
That's right.
Somebody here is worried about a relationship. You don't know how it's going to be reconciled. You're right, you can't, but God can. Somebody here is saying, man, Brother Todd, I have been so wayward. I don't know if I can ever find my way back, but God can show you. And he's standing there and he's waiting. Would we allow God to interrupt our lives and have a but God moment? Will you do that, church? I'm going to pray. This is going to be the first of a series of lessons that God's going to speak to us on. My prayer for you this evening is that you will surrender to the one who can, whatever it is that you're doing today. Whatever it is for you, whatever burden you're carrying, whatever's keeping you from being all in for God, just give it to him tonight and say, God, you just reveal that to me. God, I don't want to carry that anymore. I want to give that to you. Will you acknowledge right now that, God, I can't. I've been trying to do this in my own power. God, I can't, but God, I know that you can. Would you do that? You can do that right where you're at. I'm going to ask you to rise. I'm going to pray. We're going to come and we're going to sing immediately after my prayer. We're going to sing hymn 301. So you go ahead and rise. I'm going to ask you to just respond to the word, the hearing of God's word. Brother Larry's going to be down here. If any decision needs to be made, he'll be here to see you. Every head bowed, every eye closed right now. God, I know that you're at work in this place. And God, we as a people, we're seeking your face. And God, there has been times where we've been all in and we've waffled and we've wavered and we've allowed other things in life to interrupt us. But God, right now what we're praying is you interrupt us. God, we're giving you this time. God, I'm praying for every heart in this room. I'm praying that for truly to be revived in the spirit of what we possess in Jesus Christ. The Father, that we believe in the power of your word. We believe in the provision that you've made through your Son. We believe in your power. And Father, we want to be in all for your glory. God, will you interrupt our plans here tonight? God, will you make our thoughts be your thoughts? And our ways, may they be surrendered and that you replace them with your ways. And God, may be everything that we're in here this evening, may it all be about you. It's not about us. It has never been about us. For all things are from you and through you and to you, Lord. We acknowledge that. So, Father, you just speak to our hearts. And, Father, may we respond appropriately, knowing that you're faithful to forgive, faithful to restore. What a glorious truth that you are our God and our King. Lord, work in us. And we give you all praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing hymn 301.